this morning. And first of all, thank you very much for giving us the opportunity to be here. I am here with my colleague Kostas Papagiannopoulos, and also there are two more colleagues, Rigas Sakiris and Calliope Stara, they couldn't attend. And we have all we are all part of the members of a bigger team, as you can imagine, who have been conducting an interdisciplinary survey in Greece, and I'm going to present part of it today. My subject will be the upper upland plateaus in Greece. It's a typical upland plateaus are typical. It's a typical feature of the Greek mainland. Small-sized pieces of land, flat land, squeezed by high mountains in the mainland, in mountainous part of Greece. And I'm not going to repeat the research questions because basically they are the questions that you have formulated for this session. So I'm going to try to access them, and I would like to introduce you to our case studies. There are two places that are interesting for this presentation. One is to the north, in the region of Epirus. The other one is to the south, to the region of Peloponnese. And to the north, there is a plateau called Soudena. And you can see the location of two villages, Kato Soudena and Amos Soudena, that means lower Soudena and upper Soudena in this plateau. And then there is another one in Peloponnese, in the south. And again, there are two villages, upper Soudena and lower Soudena, in the Soudena plateau of Peloponnese. Now, the place name Soudena is rare. You can meet it in Greece only in those two localities. This drew our attention, this coincidence, but also it drew the attention of the inhabitants, because in fact there is a tradition that people from the Soudena to the north, from the north, migrated, fled during the Ottoman period to the Soudena, to the south, and they built their new homes, new villages in a plateau that resembled theirs in the north, because they felt threatened in the north. Some very, very brave men killed a Turk and they couldn't stay there anymore. So, the research question of the project was to confirm or not this narrative. But we also had the opportunity to look at other things too, which were very interesting to us. At the beginning, it seems reasonable that people moved from the north to the south, because we know that at this period of the Ottoman period, at this time, 13th, 14th, 15th century, the north suffers from population pressure, from demographic pressure, while at the same time, Peloponnese is depopulated, especially the mountains, so people would have a good reason to move from the north to the south. And also, the plateau in the south is nearly three times bigger than the plateau to the north, and also has more pasture land available, which is very important. People were active with herding, and so they needed empty pastures for their herds. So the land is actually the resource that people used in both plateaus. And this is the basic economic activity based on cultivation, small-scale cultivation and herding. As you see, I formulated the research questions to the bottom so you can remember them if you feel like. And of course, all the landscape in both places was shaped in order to serve the needs of the resource use, utilization. So for example, it's typical that villages were built on the slopes, so the land in the flat land was remained empty, so they could use it. Then water, which is a scarce good in many parts of the mountains, though it seems strange, also was something that they had to somehow devise methods to capture it, either from the rain or dig wells, or in the north use springs, but in the south, only in the south there are springs, in the north it was a very big problem. Then they had to use a complex road network for the transportation of their goods, because in fact upland plateaus are, I think Brunel says, their passages in the Mediterranean, and that's true. They're not isolated, they need to have contact, and they have keep contact with the outer world. And here you see a map of the early 19th century in the north, in Epirus, and this is the region, more or less, of our case study in the north. And what you see, well, the blue are the rivers. The red lines are there is a road network. What you don't see in this, in such kind of maps, is tracks like this one. This is found in the south. Okay, you will understand that my pictures are from both parts, from the south and the north, because so far I'm showing typical common features from both places. And in fact, this kind of uncharted road network was called Greek's roads, Romeodromi in Greek. While the official network that is charted and can be found in maps of the period are Turkodromi, Turks' roads. That was a way to discriminate roads from what is safe and what is official, and what we use now and what we don't use, and for which purpose. Then even nowadays, if you visit the places, you will still find remnants of old property markers, boundary markers, like tree alignments that you can see here, or tree clusters. Usually, tree clusters are somehow linked to some religious constraint, and they're considered, that's why you can see a church, there's always a church around here, and as a matter of fact, they are sacred woods, so they use religion. This is how a sacred wood looks from inside, and they use religion as a means to conserve parts of woods that are necessary to exist, from overgrazing or from grazing anyway, from overfilling. And besides, the plateau in the south, the plateau in Peloponnese, which lies in the heart of ancient Arcadia, is devoted to whom else? The goddess Artemis, the goddess of forests. And this Artemis was a very useful one, this goddess, and her temple, which has been excavated, because people went there to cure madness, and animals were tamed. So it meant something for them. Under the circumstances, you can imagine that the people who used the resources had built a social hierarchy to maintain their position in the settlements where they lived. And this social hierarchy is still visible in the plans of modern villages. Here you see the village of Kato Soudena in the north. And what we have in the center is the houses of the people who owned flocks or owned land, because that was very important. If you owned flocks and you owned land, you were the local aristocrats. On the other hand, if you were a blacksmith, for example, a musician, if you were a Roma, or if you didn't have your own flocks, but you were a shepherd who worked for others, you would live in the fringes of the village, of the settlement, and all this was reassured through the process of endogamy. And in this way, people knew what was their position, what was their identity within the community they lived. Okay, thank you. Now, that so far, this is the similarities that we can find between the two villages. But because and due to the different treatment that they received from the Ottoman administration in the north and the south, we have some differences that they happen take place, and we have some sociocultural forces that are released different in the south and the north. For example, in the north, privileges granted to the people who owned to the people who own land and flocks, allow them to travel around, to travel throughout the Ottoman Empire, to settle, to make companies in Europe too. Here you see a family in Egypt. Women get emancipated, men get become very wealthy, they become very well educated. These kind of people will be the ones who will prepare intellectually and financially the war of independence, the war against the Ottoman Empire, and the revolution in 1821. On the other hand, people who live in the south don't have the same privileges, and they have to manage on their own. So what they do, the people who belong to the local aristocracy, is that they make their own police forces to protect their capital, which is animals, from thieves. They acquire a mentality that is connected, a polemic mentality, a mentality that is connected to using weapons, using fighting, and as a matter of fact, some of them will be the heroic families that will start the revolution. They will physically participate in the revolution. Here you see the death of one such hero from Campo Soudena in the south. And this is his house. It has been restored. It can withstand attacks and sieges. So that is all for the past. What happens nowadays, and I'm finishing with this, is that nowadays, fortunately, the lack of heavy mechanization, the lack of extensive cultivation, has allowed us to save and find the traces of the past in the land use, because things have not changed very much. But what has changed is people. People don't live in the plateaus anymore. The schools have closed because there are no children. And what is the new resource in the area is, in both areas, both regions, is tourism. People like traveling there, spending their winter or summer holidays because it is very beautiful. Both parts belong to the UNESCO Global Geoparks, and they are, of course, national parks. There are very rare species of birds and flowers that one can see. Material from the past spread everywhere, so one can have many things to enjoy. But even this is not enough, because Greece right now is undergoing a very, you know well, economic crisis, so we need to find a new resource. And the development plans for the future is, especially in the north, gas and oil extraction. And this, as you can imagine, has terrified the inhabitants, and we are all very, very worried about it. And unless we are very, very careful with what is going to happen, and very, very alarmed, we are afraid that this beautiful arc of natural and cultural heritage will be a lost arc. Well, so thank you very much. Before leaving,